So in the lecture, yeah, applied mathematical finds, we are still in the section on interest rate models. Now models having a numerical implementation, or where we favor maybe a numerical implementation because the model is big and more generic. And we introduced the model for a discretized term structure. Yeah, the term structure where the evolution of the forward rate has been specified. So the LIBOR market model. And yeah, today I like to start talking about the calibration of the model. And the calibration of the model is the question, how do we choose the three parameters? So the three parameters of our model are the initial value, the coefficient in front of the diffusion, yeah, so the volatility. The drift term was given by the application that we do risk-neutral evaluation and move to the equivalent martingale measure. So that is not a free parameter. And of course, in our model setup, also the correlation or the instantaneous correlation of the Brownian drivers. Well, you could say that just the covariance structure of the model is a free parameter. So initial value and the covariance structure. So calibration here is the choice of the three parameters. Yeah. So how do we determine the three parameters? So, and we will determine these parameters by matching them such that the model reproduces observed market prices. So we will calibrate the model to the market. But often under the topic calibration, you find a lot of stuff related to deriving analytic formulas for those financial products. So I have a model now that we implement in a Monte Carlo simulation. And of course, I can just calibrate my parameters by applying some inversion, numerical inversion, some root finder, some numerical algorithm that optimizes the parameters, repeatedly performing valuation using the Monte Carlo simulation. But this is very slow, because whenever I change a parameter, I have to generate the random numbers again. Okay, maybe I can store the random numbers in the cache, but I have to generate the forward rates again. And I have to price the products. So every iteration in this optimization is costing me a lot of time. So for that reason, calibration is somewhat linked to finding a fast formula, so an analytic formula for the financial products that we would like to calibrate to. So this somewhat relates to finding analytic formulas for certain financial products. So for the valuation. Of certain financial products, namely those which we would like to calibrate to. Yeah, valued under this model. And the reason why this is related is, of course, to speed up the calibration. Yeah, because the calibration is actually an inversion of the mapping model parameters, yeah, maps to model, maps to value. It's an inversion. So It's an inversion of the mapping parameter defines a model, and the model defines or gives me the value of a financial product. So we have to invert these steps. Okay, so I first discuss a few obvious choices for the parameters, initial value, volatilities, correlations. Then also some techniques to reduce the number of parameters, functional forms and factor reduction. And then we will focus here on this analytic valuation, which is related here because I like to speed up this inversion. Okay, so calibration is the choice of the three parameters. Okay, and the three parameters of our model are the initial condition. So what is the initial value of my SDE? So what are the forward rates observed in T0? The volatilities and the correlation. So you could say that volatility and correlation is actually just the covariance structure. Yeah, so the volatility and the correlation. So this is just the covariance. Yeah, or the factor loadings. Yeah, so or our lambda ik. So we split it, lambda ik, into one part, sigma I, and into the to another part, the fik, which builds up the rho ij, because these parameters have maybe a better interpretation for us, and also they are maybe better now. Sigma and rho is maybe better now if you look at the calibration, but okay, they are just part of this covariance structure. And finding these parameters is called the calibration. And you see that we have many free parameters here. So if we have an interest rate curve spanning 40 years, say for example, then if we take semi-annual, so every half year, a forward rate, that's actually a quite coarse discretization, at least for the short end. For the long end, it's maybe okay. Then you have 80, maybe 79, forward rates spanning this curve. And so you already have 80 initial values. And you have 80 volatility coefficients, and each volatility coefficient here is a function of time. So I can specify a different volatility in every time step of my simulation time discretization. If the simulation time discretization is also something like 80, I have 80 times 80, actually 80 times 80 half, because the forward rate will at a certain point stop. It's a triangle. So you have already a lot of volatility coefficients. So it can be somewhat like thousands. And the same for the correlation. So this model can have a huge number of free parameters just by a fine time discretization. It's an advantage, but it's also dangerous because they can be overfitting. We have to maybe discuss this. So how do we choose the parameters? I already mentioned that we like to reproduce market prices. So one choice of the parameters is choose the parameters, the free parameters, such that the model, if you value a financial product, gives you the price that you observe on the market. But there's also maybe another alternative. So if you think of, for example, an option, a caplet. So a caplet is determined by the initial value. Assume that is already fixed. So the bond price curve, assume that is already fixed, observed today, and the volatility parameter. So So a caplet is somewhat depending here on our sigma. So now how should I choose the sigma? So I can now choose the sigma to match the caplet price which I observe on the market. But sigma is also the volatility of the forward rate. And I could also just observe the past movement, so the historical movements of the forward rate, and estimate sigma as being the variance of or the standard deviation of instantaneous changes of the changes, the log changes, depending on which sigma you use, and estimate sigma from what you have observed. So these are two different things. So one thing is what you observe and the in the past, in the stochastic process, and one thing is the value that you observe on the market. So that's an alternative. And now the question is, which of the two is actually right? Is there a right or wrong, or which is of the two is better? And that somewhat depends on the application. So think again of what we are doing here. We have derived a model under the equivalent martingale measure. So we have moved to a different probability measure. So a different probability measure means that actually we are not in the real world probabilities. We are in a somewhat artificial probability world. And why was that allowed? Because we used the model for a risk neutral valuation. So we consider a replication portfolio that neutralizes risk. And since we are in this setup, it was admissible to move to some equivalent measure where the property of replicating is still valid. That was easing the calculation because now all relative prices are martingales. So our setup is linked to the fact that we would like to perform replication, and the value which we are calculating is the value of the replication portfolio. So it's the cost of buying the replication portfolio. And now you see, it's the cost of buying the products on the market. So the relevant part is, what is the price of a product on the market to perform this replication? So it's more relevant that you match the price on the market than that you match the historical movement of the object. Actually, if you perform perfect replication, the true probability and the true stochastic nature of the object is irrelevant, because you buy the stochastic process from somebody else, you neutralize the risk, and it's the problem of this somebody else if the stochastic process is different. So for that reason, if we are in the setup of risk neutral valuation, we are actually in the setup where this is the right way of calibrating the model. However, this is not 100% true, because sometimes it may be that you perform replication, but you cannot buy the financial product that is associated with the model parameter. For example, think of Black-Scholes model for stock. You can buy the stock, but assume you cannot buy the option. Then you are performing delta hedging. So you buy the stock, but you don't buy the option. So you should match the price of the stock, which is, of course, you should have the right initial value of the model. But since you cannot buy the option, you are really exposed to the true changes of the stock. So there you should have maybe some other way of estimating sigma. It can be a historical one, but historical also has the defect that it is looking at the past, and the stuff that is relevant for you is actually the future. Okay, so, but as a rule of thumb, if you buy the financial product that is associated with a certain parameter for your replication strategy, then your model should calibrate to the market price of this financial product. Yeah? So that parameter should calibrate to the market price of that financial product. Yeah, sometimes there are no products on the market. For example, for the correlation, yeah, sometimes it's difficult to find financial products to hedge the correlation. And then we perform maybe some estimate, yeah, for the correlation. Also, the choice that we have a log normal model compared to a normal model is similar to this. Yeah? We observe the distribution on the market and we say, okay, maybe this is a good model. Yeah? This is like somehow an historical estimate. Yeah? So fixing a correlation parameter can be interpreted as some kind of a calibration. It can be also interpreted as a model choice. Okay, so the difference between these two is not 100% strict, but we have the rule of thumb. Once we have a parameter that has a strong link to a financial product, and that financial product is used in the replication, in the hedging, then we use this this market price to calibrate this parameter. So here is a small summary of what I just explained. Yeah. So if a parameter here is associated with a financial product, and if this financial product is used in the hedging, yeah, so in the replication, then the first strategy to actually match the model to this financial product is advised. Yeah. So if this one is used as part of the replication strategy, then the first approach is maybe right. Huh? So, okay, so the replication portfolio has to be set up from current market prices, from traded products. And if the model did not replicate the current market prices, the cost of replication calculated by the model would be just wrong. Yeah, because we cannot set up this replication portfolio at this price. Okay, so the model price would be wrong. So where the remark applies to all model parameters. So however, in practice, yeah, I already mentioned this, it can happen, yeah, it may be difficult, yeah, to find a market price. Or it applies to all parameters, but in practice it can be difficult to find a market price associated with a certain parameter. Yeah, for example, there's low liquidity, and in such cases, we may use a historical estimate or something else. So an example for this is, for here, the correlation parameter. Sometimes it's a bit difficult to observe. So. For our model now, yeah, for this section, I will now discuss the first approach. Yeah, so implying the parameter from a financial product price we observe. So sometimes this is then called, the parameter is then called implied parameter. Yeah? So the parameter implied by what we observe on the market. Okay, so let's start with our three parameters. How do we calibrate the initial value? Well, that's actually a trivial one. The initial value are the forward rates. The forward rates is a discretization of the interest rate curve. So when we discussed interest rate, actually we started with the object a zero coupon bond. Yeah, we start with observing zero coupon bonds. Okay, and from this zero coupon bond, we defined the forward rate as actually the bond at the beginning of the period minus the bond at the end of the period divided by the bond at the end of the period. Also, relative to the period length, yeah, it was a rate, yeah, so per time. So that was our definition of the forward rate for this period here. Observed in little t, And if the model should reproduce this interest rate curve, well, then just the initial values should be derived from the market observed prices of the zero coupon bonds. So we can easily determine here the initial value of the model. Well, there is a small thing here to do. A zero coupon bond is often not traded on the market. Yeah, on the market you find a coupon bond. We viewed a coupon bond, or you find, for example, a swap. But in our chapter on interest rate products, I showed you that you can derive the value of a coupon bond from values of zero coupon bonds. It's just a sum, and that you can derive the value of a swap from the values of zero coupon bonds. So there's already an inversion step behind this. So we observe coupon bonds, swaps, and other stuff. And from these, we calculate the zero coupon bonds. So this is sometimes called constructing the interest rate curve or bootstrapping the interest rate curve. And then if we have these, we can easily calculate our initial values. If we have these initial values, the model will reproduce the zero coupon bond prices, and hence it will reproduce the prices of the swaps or of the coupon bonds and so on. As long as, since we are here in a discretized model, we stay on the time discretization. So why is this? Because our drift ensures that we will reproduce these prices. So I already made this check in the last session, where we checked, is the numerical calculation of the zero bond consistent with the zero bond which we would calculate from the initial values. So that was what we did at the end of the last session. The numerical valuation is consistent. And this consistency is actually given that we have the right drift. So we had small errors because our drift had a numerical error, but that was a purely numerical issue. Okay, so we have reproduced the bond prices. And we have chosen the initial values. So now to the volatilities. When we started talking about our model, actually the classical form of the model was that it was just a Black model, a log normal dynamic for a forward rate. A Black model now written down for all forward rates simultaneously. So a single forward rate follows a Black model, and the value of a caplet can actually be calculated by Black's formula. If we are in this special structure where the model corresponds to a Black model. So that is if the coefficient in front of this diffusion is sigma I of t L I of t dw. Then our model is actually for this forward rate a Black model, and we can use an analytic formula. So we have an analytic formula. If the model is of the special structure that corresponds to the Bachelier model, so the coefficient is sigma I dwi, then we could use Bachelier formula. So now I would like to match a model parameter, here the sigma, so the initial value is already given, to a market price. And from the Black formula, you see that the correlation of the diffusions doesn't enter, because it was just sigma I dwi, and the other dws did not enter into the valuation. So the correlation is irrelevant. So a caplet is maybe here a good thing to determine or to check the volatility parameter. One other thing, I would like to match the caplet value, the caplet price, which I observe. And this is now a little bit similar to what I just said here for the initial value. I can calculate the initial value from a zero coupon bond price. But actually, a zero coupon bond price is not observed on the market. On the market, you observe something else. And we have first convert what we observe, the swap, to the zero coupon bond. And here, there's also often some conversion step that is already done for you by a broker. Often, they don't quote the price of a caplet. They quote the volatility that you have to use in Black model or in Bachelier model, the log normal volatility or normal. So nowadays, they often quote the normal volatility because interest rates can become negative. So they quote the volatility that you have to use in a Black model to get the right price. So instead of quoting the caplet cost you that much money, they tell you the caplet cost you that much volatility. And you plug in the volatility in the formula and you can calculate the price in a currency. So just as a small repetition, recall the concept of implied volatility. So given a market value of a caplet and given all the other parameters that you need in Black's formula or in Bachelier's formula, I can calculate the volatility parameter of this formula. So if you go back to the chapter where we derived the Black model, for example, for a caplet. So we started with a model that looked like our special version of our term structure model for a single rate. We considered the valuation here of a caplet. And we arrived at an analytic formula, which looks much like Black-Scholes formula. And there are a few parameters, like the initial value that is already determined in our model, a zero coupon bond price that is already determined by all initial values, properties of the financial product, like the strike. And of course, there was a parameter here, the sigma bar. And the sigma bar is the integral of sigma squared 1 divided by t, take the square root. So that is the sigma bar squared is the average accumulated variance over time to maturity of the product. And you see, you can calculate from this parameter, given all the others here, the price. Or from a price, you can invert this formula and calculate the sigma. So for that reason, I'm asking here, assume that I have a parameter sigma corresponding to a market price. So I have an implied volatility implied from a market price. How do I match this parameter to a parameter of the model? And we have already answered this. So if now this depends a little bit which special form of our model we are considering. So if we assume the log normal version of our model, then our model is actually identical to the Black model. So you see, this is then our model. The log normal version has here this sigma I Li. This is identical to the Black model. And we know that the integral of sigma I squared, so the integral of sigma I squared here divided by time is the square of the parameter that we should use in Black's formula. So if I take the square root, I have the Black implied Black volatility calculated from the model. And now the calibration is that this object here or this quantity should match the corresponding quantity that I observe for the market product. So calculate from the market price the implied volatility using Black's formula, the Black-Scholes formula, inversion, calculate from the model this integral, you have the implied black volatility of the model. So I have an implied black volatility from the model, and I have an black, or I have a black volatility from the model, and then have an implied black volatility on the market, and these two parameters should match. If these two parameters match, then Black's formula tells me that my model, so this guy here, will reproduce the price of the caplet I observe on the market. Okay, so the condition to calibrate the model is then just match the two volatility parameters. Okay, so match here my model parameter to the market parameter. Okay, so now my model has, my model has a whole function, sigma IL. So my model has a much higher degree of freedom. I have just one equation and I have to match a whole function. So there are multiple possibilities to calibrate the model to this single caplet. So I observe a caplet for every forward rate. So I observe only 80 caplets, for example. Actually, in the market, you observe much less. Yeah? And you have here much more degree of freedom in the model. So one possible choice is just to reduce the degree of freedom in your model. For example, you could choose all the functions being constant. Okay, that's one possible choice. But to calibrate the model to the caplet market prices, it's just this condition here that has to be fulfilled. Okay, so if the integral of my sigma I L squared matches the corresponding value we imply from the market. Okay, so we have calibrated the volatility parameter, or we have a condition that would calibrate the volatility to caplet market prices. Here I started with the log normal version. So this is only for a special version of my model. Why? Okay, because for this version of the model, I have an analytic formula. In other cases, you can still do the same using a numerical calculation of the value. Yeah? You could still calculate the value of your model caplet numerically, calculate the implied or inverse of the Black formula from this, calculate the numerical valuation of the sigma, and try to find the correct model parameter to match the market implied volatility. Yeah? So here the special case was only that I could link to our chapter, so to here equation 88, so that I could link to this chapter where I have a nice analytic formula. If we have the normal version, we can do the same. So now I can walk through some special cases. So if we have the normal version here, the normal version, then our model is here in this form. So we have here the parameter sigma I dwi. There's no L in front. So this means that my model is actually a Bachelier-like model. Yeah? So we are in the normal version of the model. So then I can do the same game, mapping to the Bachelier volatility. Yeah? So I calculate the Bachelier volatility. So that's a very similar formula here. Yeah, I can calculate the Bachelier volatility that corresponds to this model choice here. And I have the condition that the Bachelier volatility calculated in the model should match the Bachelier volatility I observe on the market price. So we have again a condition it's just a single condition because we just observe one single financial product, yeah, for every forward rate. So I match this to the Bachelier implied volatility. Of course, for this, I have to use the inversion of the Bachelier formula. So that was here equation 90. We can jump back to this. Yeah. So that was the Bachelier model for a caplet, which allowed us to map price or to link the price to this Bachelier volatility parameter here. Okay. Again, the remark, my model has a lots of freedom. I can choose here a full function. Yeah, I can show you later how we will determine the full function. There are financial products that allow this, but to match the caplet market price using the Bachelier or to using the normal version of our model, it's enough to fulfill this condition. And for example, we can fulfill it by just choosing all the sigma I of t being constant, yeah, so independent of t, yeah, a flat curve. And when we discussed here in where was that in number 110 was our dynamic for the Bachelier for the normal version. So there was the log normal one. When we discussed that, there was also this displaced version, which was somehow a mixture of the two. So it had a part that has the L here and a part that has no L here. I can also do the same for this special version and for the most general version, yeah, the one that has here a general parameter. Well, maybe I don't have an analytic formula, maybe I can derive one. If I don't have an analytic formula, I can still do the same using numerical valuation of the caplet. So I can also check the same for the displaced log normal version or the blended model. Yeah? The displaced log normal version or the blended model. So actually, for this model, it was that Li plus Di, yeah, so the shifted forward rate, was log normal distributed. And so it's possible to map this to a somewhat shifted version of Black's formula. So I don't have this shifted version of Black's formula here on the slide. Maybe that's a nice exercise to derive this. You just have to shift the initial value and the strike, yeah, and get a corresponding formula, but maybe you have to show that this holds. And you have the same approach that you calculate using this shifted formula. You calculate from the market price, the implied volatility, and you match here the volatility parameter inside the model. So this guy here, you calculate from that the integrated parameter here, and you match this one to the one you observed on the market. So for three special cases, these were three conditions that you have to fulfill. As you maybe know, I have one parameter sigma, but I can observe many different caplets because there's still the parameter strike. And it's not clear that if you calculate an implied volatility, so a volatility parameter from a caplet with a certain strike, that this strike is still the, that this volatility, this implied volatility is still the right one to value a caplet with a different strike. Okay, so how can that be? The reason is that, for example, the model that you use to calculate the implied volatility is a log normal one, but the model that is consistent with the market prices is not a log normal one. So this model assumption is wrong. Of course, you can calculate an implied log normal volatility as long as interest rates are positive. you can do this. But it's and if you do that for a single strike, yeah, you get some value. But if you do it for another strike, it can give you another value. So this mapping of for which strike do I get which implied volatility is called the Kaplan smile. Yeah, it's called smile because often it is like a smile, like a smile. Yeah, it's shaped like this. But actually, that depends which kind of implied volatility you are looking at, log normal or normal. Yeah, the shape can be different. For historical reason, this map is called the smile. Yeah, the map, the strike maps to the calculated sigma parameter. But this map can also be used to check if your model assumption is correct. So for example, if the model is a log normal model and you calculate for every strike the implied volatility, the parameter should be the same for all the strikes. If you calculate the log normal implied volatility. It just verifies if this assumption is correct. I will have a look at this later, but it somewhat relates to which of the three choices maybe is a good choice for our model: log normal, normal, or displaced. And if displaced, which displacement we should use. But I would just recall again this concept of the volatility smile. Yeah, so the model that we have considered here have actually creates three different implied volatility smiles. So these guys here, they create different volatility smiles. Let's maybe check a little bit our calibration. So let's go back here to the log normal version, and I would just do what is described here under calibration. So I would like to calculate the value of a caplet using here a certain parameter sigma IL. I calculate it numerically, and then from this numerical calculation I calculate the implied volatility by inverting Plex formula using the numerical calculation of the value. And I would like to check if the output is then consistent. Yeah? So that's similar to what we did yesterday to check the bond prices. Now I check the Kaplan prices. So let me just show you the code. It's very trivial. So I already explained yesterday that I have a small helper method here that allows me to create a model for a certain parameter set here. And now the parameter that I would like to look at is here the volatility. Yeah, so this is this parameter here. And actually, this parameter here is that my model is a log normal one. So I use now my numerical model with a parameter. I always write this wrong. With a parameter for the volatility that is 30%. And if you remember what we did here in this method that creates the model, then this volatility parameter here is used here, is actually used to choose all sigma I of t constant. So that corresponds here to this choice on the slide. Yeah, so my sigma IL is a constant parameter. So actually this should then be exactly the implied volatility. And now we do some kind of a round trip. So having this model, so we built this model, I value here a caplet. I value here a caplet with this model. Okay, I value the caplet maybe for different maturities. So maturity is running here over time. And now let's do the round trip. I have the value of the caplet, and I would like to invert this value. So where's the inversion? So the inversion is here. I would like to invert this value using the Plec formula. So this here is the inversion of the Plec formula. You can have a look here, and you see that it's actually rooting back to Black-Scholes, yeah, because Plec formula is just like Black-Scholes. And you see that this is just some Newton's method, some root finder that is always calculating Black-Scholes formula. So that this here is just the Black-Scholes formula and trying to find the correct parameter sigma. Yeah? So it's always here from the solver, from the root finder, checking, give me a new volatility, and then it's reporting the error and it's optimizing. So this here is just the inversion of the Black-Scholes formula, the Plec formula. For the Plec formula, I also need the initial value, the forward rate, and the zero coupon bond at payment. So I also calculate this from my numerical model. Yeah? So I make no analytic assumption here. I calculate all parameters from my numerical model. So we did this yesterday, calculating a zero coupon bond. This is the zero coupon bond at the payment date. Yeah? And we also did this yesterday, or in the last session, calculating the forward rate. Yeah? So I also calculate this here from the numerical model. So my numerical model gives me caplet value, zero coupon bond value, forward rate, and I can use these three to calculate the implied volatility. And if the model is consistent, this should be, again, 0.3. Yes, this should be 30%. So, and then I create some kind of plot, yeah, with this so that we can have a look at. So the only thing that you did not see yet is here this caplet. So I value a caplet. Yeah, you can have a look at this caplet if you like. So it's just here. Where is it? Oh, it's here. Okay, so this is actually the core part here. Yeah, so there's nothing special happening. It's just the forward rate minus the strike maximum of this and zero multiplied with the period length. Okay, so yeah, let's run this little program and have a look how this looks like. So this is here our caplet implied volatility calculated by inversion, yeah, of the Plec formula. And you see there is some kind of error. Yeah. So here I'm a little bit below 30, and then I'm always consistently above 30. So this is a numerical error. I use a small number of passes here. If you increase the number of passes, this can be improved. So you see that here we have some numerical error. Yeah, also maybe here, yeah, you see that this is a little bit too high. Apart from that, okay, we verify our intuition that our model reproduces the caplet price up to some numerical error in terms of implied volatility. So it reproduces the caplet price in terms of implied volatility. So that was our input, and that's our output. So before I conclude now the session on calibration to the caplet, I would like to show you something that is really scary. Yeah. If you look here, what I have plotted, it's actually the caplet at, well, exactly the discretization points of our model. Yeah. So this is 9 and this is 8.5, right? And our model that we used is using... So where was that? Let me check, where was that? Period length here. So our model is using exactly this discretization. So of course, at the discretization points, the model should be quite okay. So what actually happens if we look at this here for a much finer time discretization? So let's use 10 times as many, or even let's use 50 times as many points. Okay, so I go now in much smaller time steps, and I haven't discussed interpolation with you, but the model I'm using allows some interpolation methods, and here I'm using the most naive interpolation method. So let's try this. Yeah, that's really scary. So now it takes a bit longer to calculate all those caplets, but actually not 50 times much longer, because I'm caching a lot of values. And here it is. Okay, and I will get this plot. So what happened here? So why is this looking like this? Well, you see that we actually match the target value at the discretization points. Yeah? So these guys here are the discretization points. But after that, the implied volatility is falling down. And the reason is that in my time discretization, and this is not the time discretization of the tenor that is doing this, it's a time discretization of the Euler scheme. In my time discretization of the Euler scheme, I have the forward rate. So say a forward rate for a certain period. I only have this forward rate at fixed simulation points. And if I use a simulation point in between, I have to do something. And what I'm doing here is I'm rounding down in the simulation time. So I don't use the forward rate, which I observe at the maturity of the caplet. I use the forward rate that I observe on the time point before. But if I go to the time point before, I have actually reduced the volatility, because the option still had a lot of time, or some time, to accumulate the volatility. And this effect is, of course, much stronger if you are looking at the caplet that has small volatility, maturity, because what's relevant here is the ratio of the maturity the caplet has and the maturity I'm using by rounding the time down. Yeah, so I'm losing volatility, I'm losing time. So you could think that actually this corresponds to the parameter in the Black formula that I should use is the integrated volatility squared. Yeah. So, and what I'm doing here is that this parameter here is actually smaller. Yeah. So maybe I remove the I. So now I am on a time that is not on a discretization point. So I remove the I. And this parameter here is rounded to some TI. So that guy is now suddenly smaller. Yeah. Actually, also there shouldn't be an I here at the sigma, because I have to use forward rate that is somewhat in between. Yeah. So if this here is your forward rate discretization like this, I'm looking now to a forward rate that is maybe running from here to here. Yeah. But that's an easy part. Yeah. You can just interpolate this forward rate from these two rates here. Yeah. The problem is if you look at this rate here, it actually has volatility up to here, yeah, but this rate should have volatility up to here, and you take the volatility only up to here, yeah, so you lose this part of volatility. So that's a scary thing from the simulation time discretization. So you should either choose the simulation time discretization to match the financial products or the option maturities of your financial products, yeah, to ensure that you have enough volatility, that you have the right volatility parameter. Or you should do some kind of better implementation. For example, I can improve this by not rounding down. I can round to the nearest. If you round to the nearest, there should be some effect that actually at halfway, this here is maybe then jumping to a different value or going to a different value. So let's do this. I can also do it in the code, but let's be a little bit quicker. Then it looks like this. Yeah. So you see that halfway you jump here to another value where you use at least a portion of the volatility of the other rate, yeah, which somewhat corrects a bit this effect. Yeah. So this here is rounding to the nearest simulation time discretization point and impose this. You can check this here in the code. There is a small experiment here that creates these two pictures. It's the next one here. Yeah, it creates both pictures. Okay, so that was a side note, yeah, to the calibration of the volatilities. As long as we are on our time discretization grid, we can nicely match the volatilities. You have to be careful for what happens in between, or you choose your time discretization grid accordingly. Okay, so the next part is interesting. I would now like reproduce swaption market prices. And actually, swaptions are liquidly traded on the market, or more liquidly traded on the market. So this is an important financial product. And you remember a swap is paying different forward rates, swapping against a fixed rate. So, and the valuation of the swap was actually the float leg minus the fixed leg. And the float leg was the sum of the forward rates that were inside this swap. Yeah? So if I have a small picture, if you recall the swap, the swaption, so I'm here, yeah? So this is T0, I'm here, and the swap was actually exchanging different forward rates. So you see that inside the swap, there are maybe many forward rates. And a swap with just one period, yeah, is a forward rate agreement, yeah, exchanging the forward rate against the fixed rate. And a swaption with one period is just a caplet. So a swap is a little bit like a generalization of the caplet. So this here is the option maturity. And this here is then the swap. Yeah, so here is the start of the swap, there's the end of the swap, and there are many interest rates inside. And now, since you have an option on many interest rates, you could think that actually this is a nice product to calibrate the correlation, yeah, because there are many inside, and maybe it makes a difference if they all move in parallel or if they all move independent, yeah, or if they move with correlation minus one, yeah, so then they are maybe neutralizing each other. But what I will show you now is that the swaption is a nice product to calibrate the time structure of the volatility. And this is to some extent linked to correlation, because the time structure will influence the terminal correlation of the rates. Yeah? By accumulating volatility at different times, you can nicely modify the terminal correlation, the terminal distribution at option maturity. So I'm still here in my session where I like to calibrate volatilities. Yeah, so this here is still calibration of volatilities, and we are looking at option prices. And for that reason, I assume that the correlation is given and fixed. Now, correlation is given and fixed, and initial value is already given and fixed. Initial value is already calibrated. Correlation, we will have a look later. And I still ask myself, can I choose the volatility function? So now as a function of time to match swaption prices. So you should maybe recall here the definition of a swap rate. Yeah? So a swap rate has a certain structure. So here, this is the TI, the beginning of the swap, and this is the TJ, the end of the swap. In between, I have a time discretization, a tenor time discretization. So for simplicity, let us here assume that this discretization is actually consistent with the time discretization of our model. So our model has the same tenor time discretization as the swap. So all the swaps or swaptions fit into our time discretization. This is again the picture which I just had. Yeah? So I had the swap, and the swap runs here from TI. So this here is TI to TJ. And in between, we have here different periods. And for every such period, I can look at a forward rate. Yeah? So this here is a specific forward rate. So this here is Li plus one. But now the option on the swap has a certain maturity. So when do you exercise into the swap? And if you exercise into the swap or not, depends if the swap has positive value or negative value. Yeah? So when we derive the value for a swaption, we could show it's actually just an option on the swap, or it's an option swap rate minus strike, yeah, times annuity, yeah, so maximum of distance zero. But it's an option on the swap. And if we exercise on the swap on maturity, so where's the maturity? That is here. This is maturity. I check the value of the swap. So if I check the value of the swap at the red line, then I observe all those forward rates at TI. Maybe I take this one here. I observe this here, which is Li plus two. I observe this, yeah, to value the swap at TI. So this is different from the caplet. For the caplet, you would exercise into an option where you observe Li plus two at TI plus two. So in contrast to a caplet, this part here is missing, right? This part of volatility is missing. So this part is missing. So the forward rate moves up and down, yeah, stochastically until this time here. And then we check the value of the swap and look into the value of the swap, and we exercise the option or not. So if you now check which part of sigma is relevant for this financial product, then you see it's only sigma up to time TI. Yeah? So if I use here this example, so sigma I plus two of T enters for t in 0 up to ti, and sigma I plus 2 of t for the remaining part, so from ti to ti plus 2, so until the fixing, does not enter. Yeah, so that is this part here. That does not enter. So you see that in an option on a swap, actually it's different time slices of the forward rate volatility that enters into this swap, a swaption. Yeah, so the swap is just the value of the forward rate that enters. For the option, it's also the volatility. How did it move? Okay, so yeah, hopefully this picture is not so complicated. I have another nice little description now, but this allows to calibrate all the sigma I for certain time intervals. Also, the functional form inside the time interval is still not specified, but I have a condition for this time interval. So like for the caplet, where we had a condition for the accumulated volatility over the whole time. Yeah. So if you just look at the caplet for this rate here, you have a condition for the whole accumulated volatility. So now I have a condition also for a fractional time part, yeah? So a condition only for this part here in front and that one not. And now, since I can use different swaptions for different starting point and different endpoints, I can actually slice many different intervals for the sigmas and also for this different sigmas, yeah, with different i's, to actually derive many conditions. So how many conditions can I derive? If I have, say, 80 intervals, if I have 80 time discretizations, okay, if you have 80 time discretization points, then you only have 79 intervals, but don't care about this. So if you have some 80 intervals, yeah, then how many swaps do you have? Okay, the swaps can start at 80 different points. Yeah? And the swaps can have different lengths. Okay, they can end at 80 different points. Okay, that's not completely true because the end has to be larger than the starting point. So it's half, yeah? It's a triangle. Yeah, so it's something like 80 times 40, yeah? Or 79 times 39, whatever. Yeah? And that exactly matches to the number of intervals you have on the forward rate. Yeah? You have 80 different forward rates, and they live for 80 different time intervals. So actually 40 different times, 80 times 40, yeah, because it's also a triangle, yeah. But they live, they have that many time discretization points for that many forward rates. So now that's an interesting question. Can we use this to match all the sigmas for certain time intervals to all the swaptions? Okay, yes, you can do this. So what I will do now, I will discretize the volatility function. So corresponding to the tenor structure. Yeah, so my discretization here that I use is that the volatility for the, say here I'm using K and L. Okay, let's use K and L. The volatility for the K's interest rate, yeah, observed on time T is constant. So this is some K L for T being in the interval from T L to TL plus 1. So that gives me here many parameters. So K is the parameter running for all forward rates. So K is running from 0 to n minus 1, all forward rates. And L is running from 0 to, yeah, until the time when the rate fixes, so that is k minus one. Yeah, because then the rate is actually fixing. Okay, so I have a triangle of parameters, so many parameters. So now you observe here in the picture that a swap having a certain period start and period end, looking at a swaption on this swap, where maturity of the option, so option maturity corresponds to the starting point, that swap depends only on a certain amount of volatilities. On which volatilities does it depend? So the K only depends on which forward rates enter into the swap. So the K goes from Ti to the last one, Tj minus one. So the K goes from I to j minus one. And for which times do I observe the volatility of these forward rates? Well, only up to maturity. Yeah? So if I start counting in zero, it goes from zero to Ti minus one. Yeah? So the L here runs from zero to I minus one. So a swap has a dependency, a swaption has a dependency on a certain subset of these parameters here. And now it's that we go in the right way through these indices. Yeah? For example, the swaption that only has one period, so that ends here, and where Ti is equal to one, so there's only one time step, this depends only on a single parameter, namely sigma 1 0. Yeah? So the sigma for the forward rate L1 for the first time step from T0 to T1, sigma 1 0. Only sigma 1 0 enters into this, and actually it's a caplet. So then we have determined the first one, and we can look at a swap that depends on sigma 1 0 and maybe on another one, sigma 2 0. So I take a swap that has two periods up to here. This one depends on the sigma for this rate and the sigma for this rate. But the sigma for this rate has already been determined. That was sigma 1 0. So I can calculate sigma 2 0. So I go through all the swap endpoints. I go through all the swap endpoints, making the swap longer and longer to determine all the sigma parameters for the first time step. And then I move here the time step, so the red line, so the option maturity for the first option maturity. I move the option maturity one step further, and I can calculate the next slice of sigma parameters. So that's now the algorithm that I have here. I fix the starting point. Let's start with Ti equals T1. And then we walk inside through all the endpoints of the swap. And we consider all the swaption on these rates. And from that, we can calculate the sigma j minus one, I minus one. Yeah? So it was in my example, it was sigma 1 0, sigma 2 0. Yeah? So actually here I have labeled the numbers. So it's sigma 0 0, sigma 1 0, sigma 2 0, and so on. Yeah, because that's just, I like to start counting from zero as a programmer. And I can calculate these guys now iteratively, yeah, considering that the others have been calculated in the previous time step. Considering that the others already have been calculated from the previous iteration. So, well, I still haven't told you how we calibrate now the parameter. Okay, we can do it numerically. We can value a swaption using the Monte Carlo simulation, and we can try to optimize this parameter here using some root finder, some iterative procedure to match the numerical calculation of the swaption to the market price of the swaption. Yeah, so we observe some market price and we try to optimize this parameter. So the only thing that I have described here is a very nice dependency structure of the swaption value on the sigma parameters. So from this dependency, you can now think that, or you can now expect that it's possible, it's hopefully possible to choose this parameter here to match this price. Of course, it can be that the price on the market is not consistent. So in which sense consistent? So that there's no such parameter here. For example, you could need a volatility that is even below zero. Yeah? So the price is much less. But then the market is maybe possibly not free of arbitrage. Yeah? There is some inconsistency in the volatility. Could also be that your, be careful, initial choice of the correlation is wrong, because correlation still plays a role. Yeah? But often this thing here works. Yeah? And this is a kind of bootstrapping. So we can strip out the sigma parameters out of a huge number of observed financial products, if we observe them. So we have chosen now this time structure piecewise constant. Yeah, we have piecewise constant values for sigma I of t, but the discretization is quite fine, and maybe we cannot expect to observe even more. Yeah, so maybe that's a nice choice. So this procedure is called bootstrapping. So if we have some time, I can maybe write it down here. So what are we doing for the forward rates? We can observe different forward rates. There is, for example, here L1, L2, L3. And so on. Yeah, we can observe different sigma parameters. So this here is the time t0, this here is the time t1. So here is sigma 1, 0. So the volatility for the rate L1 from t0 to t1. Was that my index numbering? Let's check. The volatility, yes, the volatility for the rate k equals 1 for the time t0. So I have this parameter, then actually the rate is fixed. Yeah, so at this point the rate is fixed. Then I have the time t2 here. So this rate is already fixed. There is no more parameter, but this rate here, the rate 2, has a volatility from t0 to t1, and there's another volatility from t1 to t2, and then this rate is becoming fixed. Yeah? And this interest rate here below has parameters sigma 3, 0, sigma 3, 1, and sigma 3, 2. Okay, and then on the other side, I have the swaptions. The swaptions. So here we have swaptions. So a swaption on the swap rate starting in TI and ending in TJ. So maybe I draw the swaption maturity down here. So this here is TI equals 1, TI equals 2. Yeah, so I start in, So I start in T1 and T2. And then I have endpoints of the swap. Yeah? So endpoints of the swap. So the swap ends in j equals 1, j equals 2, j equals 3, and so on. Of course, there is no swap here. Yeah? A swap that ends in 1 and starts in 1 and ends in 1 is nothing. Yeah, but there is a swap that lives here. And this is the swap that starts in T1, ends in T2. Option maturity is in T1. Actually, it's a caplet. Yeah? And this guy is then the one. So the value of this swap is the one that depends on this volatility here. Okay, so now the swap that ends in T3, yeah, it has the forward rates L1 and L2, yeah, from T1 to T2 and from T2 to T3. So this guy here, or maybe I take a different color, yeah, so this guy here has actually these forward rates. The option maturity is T1, so it depends on these volatilities here. Okay, and I can calibrate this free parameter here. Okay, and so on. Yeah, so now the next one is here this guy, and this guy depends now on these ones, and you can calibrate this free parameter. So while you are running here down on the volatility parameters for L, you are running here to the right on the end point of the swap. So now you go to the next swap, you know, say the next swap is where is it? It's starting in 2, so it only can end in 3. So that's this one. So maybe I remove here this cross. Yeah, this one does not exist. So that's the swap that has one forward rate, the forward rate from T2 to T3. Option maturity is into T2. So it has a dependency on this volatility here, okay? So maybe I need now another color. Yeah, so let's take this one here in this pink, and this one depends on this guy. And now the game goes on. Yeah? So this one here depends on those volatilities. Well, actually, it depends on a bit more, yeah? So let's remove this. It depends on the volatility of the forward rate L2, but over the whole time, right? So like that. Okay, and this guy is already determined, so you calibrate this free parameter. And now the gray one depends on two forward rates over two time steps. So the gray one would depend on these guys here. Yeah? But you can calibrate now this free parameter. So while you are moving here on this side, you are moving down. Yeah? You are moving to the right here and have the next slices. Okay, so that was a nice session on the calibration of swaption. So it's possible maybe to imply the whole time structure of the sigmas by observing swaption prices. So nice one. Okay, so a last remark to conclude the session is that there is the risk of overfitting. Yeah. So I have many parameters now Observing many products can result in an overfitted model. You have to be careful that maybe the financial products you observe are not liquid or not consistent. Yeah, so that's just a remark here. And to reduce the risk of overfitting, it's possible to reduce the number of parameters. And one way to do this is to say, okay, I don't have a piecewise constant function that allows everything. I have just a function that has a certain low parameter functional form. So such a functional low parameter functional form is, for example, here, this very popular hump-shaped functional form. It has four parameters, and you now can say, okay, I like to choose these four parameters such that I get a best fit calibration to market prices. Yeah? So you calibrate the market prices in the sense that you, for example, reduce the root mean square error or something like that. That was it for the volatilities, and correlations are then part of the next session. Thank you.